On the morning of the 14th of March, 1945, the fleet carrier Bunker Hill manoeuvred its great bulk through the narrow exit channel from the Ulithi Atoll, some 1,100 miles southeast of Okinawa. Sat on the flag bridge, Vice Admiral Mark Mitcher watched as the vast armada of the fast carrier force sorted in a single column. Emerging into the deep Pacific Ocean, the force deployed into a cruising formation of four groups. Task Force 58 totaled 10 fleet and 6 light carriers, supported by 8 fast battleships and 80 other combat vessels, bristling with anti-aircraft guns to defend their more fragile cousins. Mitch's forces were to prepare the way for the invasion fleet, now massing from across the Pacific, by neutralizing enemy air power in southern Japan. After replenishing at sea on the 16th, the task groups began a high-speed run in towards Kyushu. At first light on the 18th of March, just 90 miles from the Japanese coast, Mitcher signaled his carriers to turn into the wind and commence launching their powerful air groups. The first strike waves commenced attacks against 45 airfields around 5:40 a.m., with devastating results. Bombing and strafing attacks reduced buildings to ash and rubble, cratered runways, and destroyed aircraft. During these operations, the US carrier groups came under attack from the 5th Air Fleet on Kyushu. Vice Admiral Ugaki had initially been ordered to disperse his aircraft and avoid attacking the Americans in order to conserve his strength for the coming battle off Okinawa. Alerted that Task Force 58 had sorted from Ulithi, he knew it would be impossible to preserve his forces against 4 enemy task groups. Locating the Americans late on the 17th, the following day Ugaki launched a dawn attack against Rear Admiral Radford's task group. Despite intensive defensive fire and fighter cover, Ugaki's men pressed home their attacks against the carriers. The Enterprise had a lucky escape when a bomb failed to explode. Intrepid was damaged by a near miss that started fires, killing 2 and wounding 43 of her crew. Yorktown took a bomb through her deck. The resulting explosion blew 2 holes through her hull. The deadly duel continued the following day as Task Force 58's aircraft struck further north at Japanese merchant and warships at Kure and Kobe. Ugaki counterattacked again, this time concentrating against Rear Admiral Davidson's carriers. Luck was with the Japanese pilots that day. A lone aircraft managed to slip through American defenses, scoring a direct hit on the Wasp, causing internal fires on 5 decks. However, expert American firefighting and damage control quickly brought the situation under control, and within an hour, Wasp was recovering aircraft. Casualties were high, with over 100 dead and 269 wounded. The heaviest damage and loss of life was suffered by Davidson's flagship, the Franklin. In the process of launching her second wave of aircraft, a lone Japanese plane flew low right down the flight deck, dropping 2 bombs. Explosions erupted on the hangar and flight decks. Bombs and rockets aboard the American aircraft went off, causing further damage. With the Franklin in flames and listing heavily, Davidson transferred to the cruiser Santa Fe, who came alongside to take off survivors and turn her hoses on the Franklin's roaring fires. After 3 hours, the Franklin was brought under tow by the cruiser Pittsburgh. In an incredible feat, by the morning of the 20th, the Franklin was able to make way under her own power at 15 knots. Casualties were extreme. Over a third of her crew were killed or wounded. Eventually, the most heavily damaged aircraft carrier in the world sailed 12,000 miles to the Brooklyn Naval Yard, New York. But before the Franklin was safe, she had to get out of reach of the enemy's aircraft. Determined to bring the damaged carrier home, Vice Admiral Mitcher ordered his forces to retire slowly and provide cover. On the afternoon of the 20th of March, Ukagi, sensing the chance to finish off the crippled American ship, attacked again, US fighter sweeps over Japanese airfields prevented any major attacks being launched, and consequently only the destroyer Halsey Powell was hit. Enterprise again escaped two near misses, only to receive damage from US guns when other ships trying to knock down an enemy plane aimed too low and hit her. Both sides disputed the degree of damage inflicted by Task Force 58's attacks. US pilots claimed to have destroyed 528 aircraft. The Japanese admitted to 163 lost. What is clear is that US carrier attacks against airfields on Kyushu, followed a week later by intensive bombardment of the same targets by B-29 heavy bombers, prevented the Japanese mounting any effective air raids against the invasion forces off Okinawa until the 6th of April. It would be too late to strike before or during the preliminary and main landings. On the 24th of March, the first ships of the invasion fleet arrived. These were the minesweepers, designated to sweep the approaches to Okinawa and the surrounding islands. Their slogan of "No sweep, no invasion" highlights their importance to the campaign, during which they swept over 3,000 square miles of sea to ensure the safety of invasion shipping. Although the Japanese had not carried out extensive mining operations, there proved enough devices to make trouble. Once swept channels were open on the 24th of March, Mitscher detached six fast battleships to bombard the beaches around Minatoga on Okinawa as part of the plan to deceive the Japanese about the exact location of the invasion. The following day, Mitscher's battleships were reinforced by the appearance of Admiral Dergin's 18 escort carriers. A force of light cruisers and destroyers started softening up the Kerama Islands to the west of Okinawa in preparation for the arrival of the 77th Division. Surface bombardment of intended landing sites began in earnest on the 26th of March, with the arrival of the main body of the Gunfire and Covering Force, Task Force 54. Steaming in four close columns through a 10-mile swept channel between the Keramas and Okinawa, Task Force 54 was an impressive sight. From the 26th of March to the main landings on the 1st of April, Task Force 54 pounded known and suspected Japanese positions. In total, 5,162 tons of ammunition were expended, over 27,000 rounds greater than 5 inches in caliber. Most impressive to observers were the flames and rubble thrown up by the 14 and 16-inch guns of 10 old battleships. Five of these battle wagons had been sunk or damaged at Pearl Harbor in 1941. It was perhaps fitting that they took part in the US Navy's final campaign of the war. At 8:01 a.m. on the 26th of March, the ground campaign erupted when four battalions of the 77th Division began landing on the Kerama Islands. These small land masses were unsuitable for airfields and could not support large concentrations of troops. But the roadsteads between the islands offered anchorages for fleet supply and repair vessels, minesweepers and their tenders, landing craft and boat pools. A base for flying boats responsible for anti-submarine patrols could also be established. Once secured, the Karamas would become a forward fleet base and provide a springboard for securing the tiny islands of Kezeshima, 6 to 8 miles from the southern coast of Okinawa. Not expecting an attack against the Karamas, the Japanese defences were weak and poorly manned. Resistance on Garuma consisted only of long-range sniper fire, whilst Okaji was secured without a fight. By early afternoon, Yakabi was secured. Over the next 2 days, Japanese troops had to be routed out of hills and caves on the Aka and Zamami Islands. The largest island, Tokoshiki, was quickly secured, except for the continued resistance of the garrison in the hills. By the 29th of March, all the islands were secured, followed by the Kaiseishima 2 days later. Casualties were surprisingly low, with 31 killed and 84 wounded. Over 121 Japanese had been taken prisoner, offering hope to US commanders that Okinawa may be as easy to subdue. At dawn on Easter Sunday, the 1st of April, over 1,300 American ships packed the waters around Okinawa. Just after 4 a.m., thousands of Marines and soldiers began climbing down scrambling nets into landing craft alongside their transports. Specialized tank landing ships spread their yawning bow doors and launched a wave of amphibious M4A4 Sherman tanks. Behind them, 5 to 7 waves of Amtraks formed up 4,000 yards from the beaches. These armored troop carriers were designed to take the infantry safely to the shore and then over the exposed beaches. As hundreds of assault craft moved into position, warships and other fire support craft continued to saturate the beaches with the heaviest pre-invasion bombardment of the war. Over 44,000 shells of between 5 and 16 inches in caliber were fired to prepare the way for the landing forces. At 8 a.m., command ships dipped their signal pennants, and along an 8-mile front, the waves of assault craft carrying men of the 1st and 6th Marine and 7th and 96th Army Divisions began the final approach to Okinawa. Ahead of them, smaller artillery and rocket-armed monitors raced forwards to deliver point-blank salvos in the final moments before landing. At 8:42 a.m., the first wave hit the Hagushi beaches. Throughout the day, this choreographed landing procedure continued as successive waves formed on the departure line and then made for the shore. In the first hour, 16,000 troops were landed. By nightfall, 60,000 troops with stores, vehicles and artillery were secured in a large bridgehead. The opening day of Operation Iceberg had surpassed all expectations. Airfields at Yontan and Kadena were secured at a cost of relatively few casualties. The night, however, was eerily quiet. US commanders were puzzled. Why hadn't the anticipated Japanese retaliation started? Where was the enemy? Lieutenant General Ushijima and most of the 32nd Army were, as planned, dug in far to the south. During the 1st of April, Ushijima and his staff had observed the US operations from the high ground near Shuri. Unable to obtain accurate intelligence about the location of the main Japanese positions, the seasoned troops of the 3rd Amphibious and 24th Army Corps continued to push quickly inland against sporadic enemy resistance. With the eastern coast reached by the 3rd of April, the center of Okinawa was under US control. Lieutenant General Buckner decided to accelerate his plans. Originally, 3rd Amphibious Corps' strike north was scheduled for phase 3 of the operation. These forces were ordered to proceed and take the Motobu Peninsula simultaneously with 24th Army Corps' thrust south. Over the next 2 weeks, the Marines of Major General Roy Geiger's 3rd Amphibious Corps made rapid progress in clearing northern Okinawa. Apart from crushing two small pockets of Japanese troops, the only obstacle facing the Marines was the rugged terrain. As they pushed forwards, service and engineer troops repaired roads and built bridges to support the speed of operations. On the 7th of April, the only substantial Japanese forces facing Geiger's Marines had been sealed into the Motobu Peninsula. 6 days later, tank infantry teams of the 6th Marine Division reached the northern tip of the island. 3rd Amphibious Corps began preparations to stamp out the isolated Japanese. Being so ahead of schedule, the Marines had reason to be confident of a swift end to the campaign. Hopes of a swift land victory were extinguished as the 7th and 96th Divisions of 24th Army Corps reached the outer positions of Ushijima's Shuri defense barrier. Near Arakuchi was a 450-foot ridge, nicknamed the Pinnacle because of a 30-foot coral spike on its summit. On the 5th of April, 7th Division tried to take this position, but was driven back. The Japanese defenses on this ridge were a taster of what lay in store along the main defensive line further south. The Pinnacle was defended by a company of 120 Japanese of the 14th Independent Battalion, led by 1st Lieutenant Seiji Tanagawa. The ridge was honeycombed with trenches, pits and underground passages, with all the main approaches mined and covered with barbed wire. The base of the hill was defended by 10 light and heavy machine guns, supported by 7 50mm mortars. From these positions, the Japanese could shelter from the initial enemy artillery barrage. When the barrage lifted, the defenders could emerge unscathed to concentrate fire on US infantry struggling over the wire and mines. On the 6th of April, fresh attempts were made to overrun Tanagawa's position. Under cover of a short preparatory artillery barrage, B Company started to make swift progress. But as the US troops neared the top, they came under intense small arms fire from Japanese troops who'd rushed from the caves they'd taken cover in during the barrage. B Company desperately held on to its gains for a quarter of an hour before being forced to retire. When the attack was renewed an hour later, the Japanese raced from their caves, some actually running through the artillery fire, to push the Americans back again. Soon afterwards, Tanagawa, directing the battle from the Pinnacle, was ready for B Company's third attack, seen massing below. So concerned was Tanagawa in dealing with the threat from his front that he completely missed C Company's attack from the flank until it was too late. The US troops swarmed over the ridge, systematically wiping the enemy out with grenades and flamethrowers. The fighting at the Pinnacle established a pattern in which the Japanese proved extremely effective at dealing with frontal attacks, but very poor at responding to flanking movements. As the fight for the Pinnacle raged on, further west, the 96th Division had been heavily engaged around the feature dubbed Cactus Ridge. This position caused considerable problems because of its anti-tank moat and mined approaches that again restricted the direction of the US attack. Consequently, the American officers assigned to take the ridge decided that a stand-up frontal charge was the only option. Over the next 24 hours, several such American banzai charges placed the ridge in their hands. The battle for Okinawa was to see a combination of the subtle tactics at the Pinnacle and the direct assault used at Cactus Ridge. Over the next few days, Hodge's divisions continued their increasingly slow move south against the outer works of 32nd Army's main line around Shuri. During fighting for the Tomb and Triangulation Hills, the 7th Division ran into crippling Japanese artillery fire. The barrage devastated the American tactic of using infantry tank teams by driving the infantry back and disabling the tanks, whose trapped crews were then bayoneted. By the 8th of April, a series of bloody assaults secured the Japanese positions. Soon afterwards, an attempt to outflank the next Japanese positions was repulsed by undetected enemy positions to the rear. The discovery of these supporting positions in depth convinced 7th Division's commanders that they had reached the main enemy defense line. A similar conclusion was drawn by the 96th Division, who had just received a costly repulse at the foot of the formidable defenses around the Kazaku Ridge. After a week of confusion and suspicion, Lieutenant General Buckner finally located the enemy. But with so many lives already lost, this discovery offered little comfort. While the US 10th Army probed towards the main Japanese positions on Okinawa, the vast armada of ships continued to unload troops and supplies. Although Imperial General Headquarters had authorized its Operation Tengo defense plan for Okinawa on the 25th of March, The destruction caused by US airstrikes against Kyushu prevented any air raids until the 6th of April. That day, Admiral Toyoda launched the first Kikusui attack of over 900 aircraft, 355 of them kamikazes. The first US vessels to suffer were the exposed radar pickets. By nightfall, three had been lost. Eight destroyers were also damaged, and two ammunition ships and a transport also sunk. The following day, Toyoda threw in another massive attack. A kamikaze penetrated the defense screen off Hagushi beaches, crashing into the battleship Maryland, inflicting over 50 casualties. A group of 20 aircraft approaching the transport area failed to score any successes, losing 12 to fighter and anti-aircraft fire. Once again, the radar pickets suffered at the hands of overwhelming enemy numbers. The destroyer escort USS Western was hit by a kamikaze that thundered out of the clouds while her guns were firing on three sides. Fires ripped through her decks and power was lost, but managing the damage brought the situation under control and she was able to make her way to Kerama. Taking advantage of the absence of the strike groups from the carriers of Task Force 58, Toyoda mounted a series of powerful attacks against the carriers. On Okinawa, as Buckner prepared for a major attack on the main Japanese defenses in the south, final plans to secure the north of the island were made. These involved simultaneous attacks against the Motobu Peninsula and the nearby island of Iishima. The center of Japanese resistance on the Motobu Peninsula was the Yaitake Hill Mass, which was defended by Colonel Udo and 2,000 troops. Initially, the 6th Marine Division's operations were hampered by low cloud cover and dense vegetation, preventing aerial reconnaissance from locating Udo's main position. Snipers added to the confusion, drawing the Marines in the wrong direction. In the end, the chance capture of an enemy map on the 13th of April finally revealed Udo's position, and the Marines immediately positioned four battalions around Yaitake for an assault. On the 16th of April, as the two battalions pressured the Japanese from the east, two battalions of the 4th Marine Regiment moved to seize the crest from the north, aided by a thrust by the 1st Battalion, 4th Marine Regiment, from the south. In the face of heavy mortar and small arms fire, this concentric assault managed to secure the crest of the position in a series of charges. But this still left the Marines with the task of securing the rest of Udo's positions in the area. A determined and well-planned attack on the 17th of April routed the remaining Japanese troops from the Yaitake position. Lieutenant Colonel John Moreau's 1st Battalion, 29th Marine Regiment, carried out a skillful deception plan that distracted the enemy from his main force, scaling the almost sheer cliffs on the south side of the main peak. By evening, two companies held the summit. At the same time, the 4th Marines moved rapidly north through enemy positions, killing 700 Japanese. Counter-guerrilla operations against remaining small pockets of Japanese continued well into May, when the 6th Marine Division was shifted south to the main battle. As the Marines cleared the mainland, the 77th Division disembarked to secure Iishima. The island was an ideal location for an early warning radar, and its three airfields would provide much-needed air support for operations ashore and at sea. Assuming the best beaches would be heavily defended, the division landed under naval gunfire at a less favorable landing site, catching the Japanese by surprise. But the advantage was short-lived. The main Japanese defenses were located around the town of Ie and the ridges approaching the steep slopes of Mount Iigasugu. The main barrier to an advance against the defenses on Mount Iigasugu was a height soon dubbed Bloody Ridge by the Americans. At the summit of Bloody Ridge was a concrete building which the 77th Division called Government Hill House. Defending these positions were 2,000 troops and civilians, including women carrying wooden spears. Despite the unopposed landings of the 16th of April, over the next 2 days, the Americans failed to secure Bloody Ridge in the face of powerful Japanese counterattacks. Major General Andrew Bruce, commanding 77th Division, was forced to review his plans and prepare a series of fresh and ultimately successful attacks. The 305th and 307th Regiments renewed a slow advance through the town and west onto Bloody Ridge. The main attack by the 306th Regimental Combat Team fell from the north. Government House was secured by the 307th Regiment and then held in the face of ferocious enemy counterattacks. G Company 2nd Battalion counted 280 Japanese bodies in front of its positions. With Government House and EA secured, the Americans moved swiftly against the last positions on Mount Eigasugu. The peak was finally captured just before 2 o'clock, when the American flag was raised. Many Japanese and civilians still remained in the caves, and on the 22nd of April they mounted a futile attack. At the end, over 4,700 Japanese, including 1,500 civilians, had been killed. US losses totaled 172 dead and over 900 wounded. The cost was worth it for possession of airfields that by the end of the month provided vital cover to shipping off the Haguchi and recently secured Nakagosuku beaches. Having spent several days bringing up fresh aircraft to replace the heavy losses from earlier attacks, Admiral Toyoda's forces struck again at Spruance's fleet clustered around Okinawa. Three Kikisui attacks were mounted between the 11th and the 16th of April. Warned about the first of these attacks by a talkative Japanese prisoner, Micha cancelled plans for air support over Okinawa and readied Task Force 58 for imminent attack. The British Pacific Fleet moved to strike airfields on Formosa to lessen the threat from Spruance's left flank. The gunfire support group was reduced to the bare minimum for shore support, so that most of its vessels could cruise at sea in a tight formation for maximum defence. On the 11th of April, the Allies met the resolute attacks of 185 kamikazes and 45 torpedo bombers. In line with Japanese planning, 150 fighters were armed to sweep aside enemy cap for the attack aircraft. This proved a complete failure. North of Okinawa, US fighters outgunned their less experienced opponents in a series of fierce skirmishes that cost the Japanese nearly a quarter of their aircraft. This pattern of events was repeated the following day, and again on the 16th of April, with the radar pickets once more bearing the brunt of the attacks. One of these, the destroyer Laffey, might have been excused from thinking that it was the sole aim of the attacks on the 16th of April. In 80 minutes, she suffered 22 separate attacks. Hit by 4 bombs and 6 kamikazes, only brilliant ship handling, damage control, and the bravery of her gunners saved her. Over this 3-day aerial assault, 2 destroyers were sunk and 10 were damaged. 8 other vessels were hit, including the carriers Essex, Enterprise, Intrepid, and the battleship Tennessee. The next Kikisui raids were not mounted until the 28th and 29th of April, while the Japanese replenished their exhausted air units. Even so, every day throughout April, the US Navy and the British Pacific Fleet were attacked by up to 20 planes that exacted a small but steady toll. Thank you. As the Marines secured northern Okinawa and Vice Admiral Spruance's 5th Fleet rode out the massed kamikaze attacks, 10th U.S. Army maneuvered into position for a major assault against the 1st of Ushijima's defense lines in front of Shuri. The 7th and 96th Divisions spent the 14th to the 19th of April reconnoitering enemy positions and mounting limited attacks to secure jumping-off points for a major offensive. To ensure the maximum chance of success against what were clearly strong enemy positions, Lieutenant General Buckner landed the 27th Division to reinforce the assault scheduled for the 19th of April. Facing the Americans were a series of heavily fortified ridges running east-west across the 4-mile isthmus. On the American right, the 27th Division was faced by a river crossing followed by an advance over rice fields, all under observation from enemy positions on Kazaku Ridge. In the center, the 96th Division faced the modest but well-defended Tombstone, Nishibaru and Tanabaru features. On the far right, the 7th Division was opposed by Hill 178 and the town of Uuki. Behind the forward positions ran the 200-foot-high Urasoe Mura escarpment, followed by rough ground up to the Japanese inner defense ring around Shuri and Lieutenant General Ushijima's headquarters. Defending the Japanese positions were veteran troops of the 62nd Division. It would take over 5 days of heavy and often confused close-quarter fighting for Buckner's men to break what they named the Machinato Line. The advance on the 19th of April was preceded by a tremendous artillery barrage. Buckner massed the greatest concentration of ground artillery in the Pacific War, assisted by warships and hundreds of aircraft strafing, rocketing, bombing, and napalming enemy positions. The Japanese, hidden deep within their shelters, waited until the fire finished and then rushed to their positions before the American assault infantry could overrun them. Once again, US troops were confronted by well-fortified and skillfully linked underground and reverse slope positions, backed by a range of artillery. These were in turn reinforced with savage, often suicidal, counterattacks. Very quickly, the three-division attack collapsed into a series of individual battles. After conducting a skilled river crossing outflanking the Kazaku Ridge to the west, 27th Division was halted at the western end of the Urasoe Mura Ridge. In the center, 96th Division struggled to gain a series of toeholds on the Nishibaru Ridge. To the east, the 7th Division made no progress. Over the next few days, some of the bitterest and most chaotic fighting centered around a salient on the Kazaku Ridge. With the flanks of the 27th and 96th Divisions threatened, Japanese positions had to be reduced. Moving methodically west to east, elements of the 27th Division had nearly cleared the ridge by the afternoon of the 20th of April. However, the desperate fighting on the Urasuramuru Ridge required forces to be diverted away from Kazaku. The aggressive Japanese defenders immediately rushed more troops and mortars back onto the ridge. With enemy troops in its rear and no reserves, 27th Division was in a dangerous position. Only by borrowing troops from other formations did it finally encircle Kazaku Ridge. On the 24th of April, Bradford Force, equipped with tanks, armored flamethrowers, and self-propelled artillery, attacked to wipe out the Japanese, only to find they had escaped from under their noses. The central position of the Nishibaru Ridge made 96th Division's advance difficult. Fire from flanking positions and massed artillery took a heavy toll amongst the advancing troops. The Japanese waged a ferocious defense, mounting local counterattacks at every opportunity to drive off the tenuous American gains. Tanks and armored flamethrowers were delayed by the need to build crossing points across a nearby gorge. Although these vehicles subjected the Nishibaru-Tanabaru escarpments to severe attack, the Japanese retained the reverse slope. Like the rest of the Machinato line, the Nishibaru position finally fell with relative ease on the 24th of April, as 32nd Japanese Army withdrew to the inner Shuri defense line. Ushijima's reason for this decision was the realization that the Americans were on the verge of penetrating his outer defensive ring. Rather than allowing the Americans to seize the initiative and fight a fluid battle in the open, where their firepower would devastate Japanese forces, Ushijima decided to force them to fight another costly frontal battle against well-prepared defenses. Despite swiftly following up 32nd Army's retirement, in the last days of April, the battered and exhausted 24th U.S. Army Corps made little headway against the inner Shuri defense line. Facing the strongest Japanese defenses in the Pacific War, Lieutenant General Buckner decided to relieve the 27th and 96th Divisions by sending 3rd Amphibious Corps south. Buckner's actions sparked controversy. The senior Marine officer, Major General Roy Geiger, argued for using his forces in an outflanking operation with landings on the Minatoga beaches. Once ashore, the Marines could collapse the exposed Japanese defenses from the rear with relative ease. While there were strong arguments for the Marines' amphibious maneuver, planners of the Navy and of 10th Army had legitimate reservations. The troops of 24th Corps were close to collapse. This would have left only two divisions of 3rd Amphibious Corps for landings against the strongly defended beaches around Minatoga. Above all, it was the naval commanders whose opinion counted most. They were adamant that in the face of heavy enemy air attacks, they could not spare the covering forces necessary to protect another transport group off Okinawa. In an ironic twist, unknown to the Americans, Ushijima had already moved the 24th Division from the Minatoga sector to reinforce the battered 62nd Division before Shuri. By the start of May, Buckner's forces had completed their reorganization with the 1st Marine and 77th Divisions moving into the line for another three-division assault. By this time, US intelligence and front commanders had dismissed the possibility of large-scale Japanese counterattacks. On the 4th of May, their confidence was rudely shattered. Ever since the American landings, Imperial General Headquarters and more aggressive members of 32nd Army's staff had been advocating a more positive strategy. Major General Isamu Cho had been cajoling Ushijima to mount an attack in early April. Colonel Yahara had opposed this shift from his original defensive concept. In the second week of May, Yahara again found himself strongly opposing Cho's demand for a major counteroffensive. To Yahara, any attack was futile and would only weaken 32nd Army's ability to prolong the battle. Under the cover of an artillery barrage, the assault regiments aimed to overrun the American artillery lines before the guns could respond. Amphibious raids were to attack the enemy from both flanks along the coast. Within hours, Yahara's predictions came true. All along the line, the offensive was an abject failure. US casualties were 649 dead. They counted over 6,237 Japanese bodies in front of their positions. The failure of Ushijima's counterattack did not prevent his troops from putting up a strong resistance against 24th Corps' subsequent attempts to secure jumping-off positions for a general assault on the inner Shuri line. These positions were finally secured at great cost. Buckner then reinforced his front with the 6th Marine Division and replaced 7th Division with the 96th. Orders were issued for an attack to envelop the Shuri line from east and west on the 11th of May. By now, US forces had adapted their tactics to the unique situation on Okinawa. General artillery barrages were rejected in favor of pinpoint fire against specific targets. VT proximity shells that burst directly over enemy trenches, showering them with lethal splinters, were also rushed to Okinawa. Infantry tank teams were extensively deployed where ground permitted. Most effective was the combination of small arms fire to neutralize enemy positions so that infantry teams using flamethrowers and demolition charges could destroy the enemy in what Buckner termed blowtorch and corkscrew tactics. At first, the new American tactics achieved little, as 10th Army's attack broke down into a series of individual pitched battles. In the west, the two Marine divisions pushed slowly south towards the Asato River behind the Shuri Heights, from where the Japanese poured in constant harassing fire. The hinge of the enemy positions in this sector was a complex of three hills. One of these, the Sugarloaf, proved the 6th Marines' toughest fight of the campaign. Despite tank, artillery and naval gunfire, the 6th Marines repeatedly failed to move over the crest against Japanese rear slope positions. It took 4 days of bitter fighting before Sugarloaf fell. It cost the Marines 2,662 casualties, and significantly a further 1,662 from combat fatigue. There was little respite for the Marines, who now had to batter their way through an equally strong defense complex around Horseshoe and Crescent Hills. The 1st Marine and 77th Divisions experienced equally tough opposition. Yet, in an attack on the Dakeshi Ridge, the Marines demonstrated that they were learning how to deal more effectively with Japanese tactics. On the 11th of May, a force of tanks was infiltrated behind the Dakeshi Ridge. There, they fired on Japanese troops running from their sheltered reverse slope positions to drive off the anticipated frontal attack after a preliminary artillery barrage. Marines were then able to move forwards and clear the remaining enemy positions. The 10th Army's decisive breakthrough during the 10-day battle before the Shuri Line came unexpectedly in the east from 96th Division. The key to the Japanese defenses in this sector was Conical Hill. The corps and divisional commanders believed that only an attack from the west could succeed because of enemy positions on high ground dominating the eastern approaches to the position. In the end, Conical Hill was taken from the east. Two platoon commanders chose to surprise the enemy by attacking through a stronger natural position, which they correctly guessed was only lightly defended. With Conical Hill taken, US forces were in a position to race into the Japanese rear and envelop Shuri. It seemed to all at 10th Army headquarters that the final destruction of 32nd Japanese Army was imminent. In mid-May, it became clear to Lieutenant General Ushijima that American forces were close to achieving a breakthrough of his last defensive line. Ignoring the advice of Major General Cho and his staff for a last-ditch defense centered on Shuri, Ushijima ordered a withdrawal to fresh positions in the south. When US 10th Army headquarters realized the Japanese were withdrawing, rather than preparing for a last stand at Shuri, it ordered a general advance. Although the skeleton Japanese forces still covering Shuri were quickly overcome, lack of intelligence and the arrival of torrential rains prevented Buckner's forces from turning Ushijima's retreat into a rout. Buckner's optimism that the Japanese would not be able to establish another strong defense line was quickly proved wrong. The few days' preparation afforded to the Japanese by the slow American pursuit enabled them to move into position on a massive escarpment comprising two formations, Yuzadake and Yezudake. By this stage of the campaign, 32nd Army had only 14,000 troops, albeit with substantial fire support, to defend this formidable position with its 100-foot northern cliff face. Despite the futility of their position and the horrendous losses they had suffered, Ushijima's men were still ready to obey orders to fight to the death. On the 6th of June, US forces began their final offensive of the Okinawa campaign. In the west, 1st Marine Division began a grueling six-day battle on the Ryukyu Peninsula to eliminate the Naval Defense Force, which had chosen to die on its own rather than with the army. In the center, fierce fighting pushed the US 96th Division to take a low ridge below the main Yuzo Yaizu escarpment, which was needed as a jumping-off point for the main assault. One company of the 381st Regiment suffered over 50% casualties trying to cross open ground from pre-registered enemy guns before being forced to retire. Over 5 days, the American division made only marginal gains. Fighting for the Yuzo Yaizu position and supporting position of Konishi Ridge to the west lasted until the 17th of June, when an exhausted Japanese defense finally collapsed under unremitting American pressure. Japanese resistance continued over the next week, but with the last major defensive positions in American hands, opposition usually consisted of small, isolated pockets holding out against well-organized combat units with tank support. Only 24th Japanese Division held out to the end as an organized force at Madeira. For the rest of the time, the battle became a manhunt, with Ushijima's disorganized forces fleeing before guns and flamethrowers, or surrendering in rising numbers. Okinawa was officially declared secure on the 22nd of June 1945. Neither of the two land commanders lived to witness the American victory. Ushijima took his own life by ritual suicide rather than endure the dishonor of surrender. The Americans paid a high price for success on Okinawa. Over 7,213 soldiers and Marines were killed, and another 31,000 wounded. At sea, the American and the small Allied force lost 36 ships, with 368 damaged. Japanese losses dwarfed those of the Americans. Around 110,000 men lost their lives, and 7,400 were taken prisoner. Over 7,800 planes were lost to just 773 American aircraft. Yamato, the largest battleship ever built, had also been ruthlessly crushed under American naval air power. As the bitter campaign for Okinawa was fought out from April to June 1945, Japanese and American planners prepared for the final battle on the Japanese home islands. Japan's plight in late 1945 was obvious to her leaders, but the question of unconditional surrender and the desire for assurances about the continuance of the emperor's rule prevented them from making peace. US leaders, shocked by the casualties and the hopeless, suicidal, seemingly fanatical nature of Japanese resistance on Okinawa, looked for another way of ending the war without resorting to a costly and protracted invasion. In defending the home islands, Imperial General Headquarters faced the dilemma that it could not adopt the passive tactics utilized on Okinawa. Japan could only be saved by defeating an American invasion at the water's edge, or through large counterattacks further inland. The problem was that, as the Americans had shown on Okinawa, Japanese forces advancing in the open would be annihilated by vastly superior US firepower. And for the invasion of Japan, American planners were mustering the most powerful amphibious force of the war. As a result, US planners estimated their casualties for the decisive phase of the invasion at 126,000. Heavy as the figure may seem, it was no greater than many other battles of the Second World War. Yet the cost of Okinawa continued to haunt many American leaders. After the successful detonation of an atomic device on the 16th of July, they had a new and more powerful weapon with which to break Japanese resolve in a series of shock attacks. Consequently, on the 6th of August at Hiroshima, the first atomic bomb was dropped. And on the 9th of August, Nagasaki was destroyed by a second atomic weapon. The effect of these events finally convinced Emperor Hirohito to instruct his divided cabinet to end the war. On the 15th of August, Hirohito personally informed a stunned nation that as the war was not progressing in Japan's favor, they must bear the unbearable. On the 2nd of September, aboard the battleship Missouri, Japan officially surrendered to the Allied powers.